Right, welcome to the first ever video podcast of the from the View from the Allotment End, lads. I'm Darren Norton, knocking on one on Twitter. This is Nick Quantrill, at Nick Quantrill on Twitter, local media celebrity, City of Culture ambassador. To my right, Rick Skelton, Hull City Live on Twitter. What he doesn't know about Hull City is nobody's business. And in front of me, and the reason why we're here tonight, is Pete Fleming, East Hull Pete. We've decided to knock a podcast together, or vodcast, or whatever the word is, in lieu of writing a fanzine every other week.
It's not a vodcast, is it? It's not a vodcast.
Is it a vlog?
It's a vlog.
It's a vlog. It's a vlog. Apparently. Yeah, yeah. I got told off calling it vodcast, what do you know? So we thought we'd all just have a get-together in my... the salubrious surrounds of my kitchen, and all talk about football. So, without no further ado, we'll probably just touch on Ferriby to start with. We'd like to cover a bit on Hull City, and we'll finish off with the sort of local football scene, local non-league, etc. So, Ferriby, we'll go back fortnight to the Dagenham Redbridge game. Disappointing all round in terms of the result, but I think we'd all agree that 4-0 flattered the visitors.
I don't know if it did. I thought Dagenham were a really decent side in that game. You know, I thought they were good and that they were strong. You could tell it was a full-time outfit, I think.
Yeah.
I think it's kind of the story of every season, isn't it? You know, there's kind of lots of good, there's good stuff in there, there's bad stuff. It's just been 10% better in both boxes, I think. You know, it's been a little bit sharper, isn't it? You know, like when Reece Thompson got around the keeper at York, he scored it. Against Dagenham being around the keeper and he hits the side net. It's just that being a little bit better at times, you know, a little bit sharper.
Yeah, I mean, I can see why you think it maybe flattered Dagenham. Because the Ferriby had a lot of the game. But Nick's right, it's them both boxes. That's where it matters. And Dagenham were better in both boxes, particularly in Ferriby's. They were absolutely clinical. I mean, in the first half, they scored 3 from 3 chances. And I thought they were a good outfit as well. And I think... Nick had warned us before the game, had some inside info, didn't he?
Yeah, one of my writing mates is a big Dagenham fan, and he was saying, you know, Guttridge, the captain, was in number 10, wasn't he? Yeah. Centre midfield, he ran the game, he ref the game, he coached the game, didn't he? He was outstanding.
He was, yeah.
He refed it.
Yeah. And he turned up, and I think he made the first 2 goals, he scored the third one.
Yeah.
And then, like, when the ball was in play, he was just organised everything, wasn't he?
Yeah,
it was like having a coach with a load of little kids, and he was telling them, you stand there, you move there, you do this. And you kind of wonder, can they play the game without him?
Yeah, and I think that was proof because he told me that when he was injured, they were winning matches.
Yeah.
As soon as he comes back into the side, you know, they've got that kind of direction again. And that's probably what Ferriby lacked a lot of the season, into just that kind of old head.
Yeah.
Who's maybe got 300 league matches under his belt. You know, who can direct a team around the pitch and organise a defence.
He gave him conversion.
He did, yeah, he did. And I mean, that's not been critical of what Ferriby have got, because we know the budget is what it is, isn't it? And... he's asking young lads to do men's jobs, isn't he, effectively?
Yeah.
It's coming on to us a little bit now, I think, and it's going to get harder. But
it's ironic because at the start of the season, we were crying out for young local lads, weren't we, to play for the team. I think, in some respects, we've gone a bit too far that way, haven't we, in terms of we've got probably the average age of the team is 22, 23.
Yeah, I mean, you look at the captains, don't you? You're asking lads like Ben Middleton to captain the team, Ryan Powerfield on Saturday. These are young players, aren't they? Well, they're in their own game, aren't they? Never mind sort of taking the responsibility of bringing other people along with them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think, I mean, Ferriby could win other games if they're playing that well.
They're in the middle
Because, I mean, in fairness to them, I mean, I can't think of many games I've seen Ferriby make more chances than he take them, which is where it matters. But they're playing well themselves. But Dagenham, I think, were really clinical. So if they can take that into the games against teams around them, certainly I think they were probably better against Dagenham than they were against York, but they beat York.
Yeah. It's that kind of Premier League thing, isn't it? Leagues within leagues, isn't it, almost? You know, like you say, Dagenham's your Lincoln, you think, well, anything we get from teams like that is a bonus. It's the games against you know, working in it, coming up soon, guys, the teams around you in the league, that you've got to go out and
they've certainly come on a long way since they played Lincoln away.
Well, exactly, yeah. I mean, even from the summer when, you know, when we kind of saw the squad coming together, you know, everyone was kind of fearful, wasn't it? Like, who's actually going to play for the team this year? They literally weren't a team, was he, in the summer?
No.
I think Houchin deserves a lot of credit by him and stamping out what they've put together to have a team that's still got every chance of staying up.
Yeah, I mean, they got far more points than I thought they would get.
I mean, Rory Watson, I think that's probably a reason, isn't it?
Yeah, I was at Rory. Yeah. It's been fantastic. But they haven't won you didn't see that early in the season. I mean, when they weren't putting the ball in the net, certainly couldn't see them winning 7-8 games.
Yeah, well, I've got us down for my second bottom with 7 wins, and we're above York, who've actually got 4 wins. It's the fact that they've drawn, they've got 10 draws under their belt. That's the only points that's sort of keeping them within touching distance, really. So I think, like you say, at the start of the season, if you'd have said we'd had 3 more wins than York mid-January,
I think it shows the potential as well, doesn't it? Because in the other part of the season, there were so many games where games were being thrown away and points were being tossed away in like the last 5 minutes, where week after week, where that's kind of gone now, hasn't it? I think to an extent.
Yeah, I think they're getting stronger.
Yeah, you know, maybe it's just been a bit more streetwise, isn't it? I think, you know, managing games better. That's kind of come, I think, as the season gone on.
Well, touching on 1-0 defeats was Saturday's at Wrexham. Probably expected, but still maybe a touch disappointing, given the performance, given that Rory Watson was without doubt the man of the match. again, an expected defeat, as such, we don't expect to go to places like Wrexham and pick up points. But this Saturday, we've got Southport coming up, and it starts a run of what I would class as winnable matches, really. Back end of this month, into next month, we've got Southport, Guiseley, Woking, Bromley and Solihull. 2 at home, they're 3 at home, 2 away. There's a good massive chance to pick up some points there before the end of February, really.
Yeah, I mean, they've competed with all of those teams in the games. I mean, they nearly won at Woking. Southport was another game at home where they had a lot of chances. I thought Southport were a decent team, actually. They haven't improved a lot, haven't they, since that game?
I still remember they were physical and organised.
But yeah, they are games that they've got to be in, and they've got to be getting some points, really. I mean, if they're going to stay up, which, I mean, there's other arguments there, I guess, we'll come to whether they can stay up because of the ground situation, but if they're going to stay up on the pitch, I think these 5 games are really crucial.
I think a big thing about that as well is that you've got Curtis Bates and Conor Oliver coming back to fitness just at the right time for these matches, either to make a big push for points in them games. You know, I mean, there's still other issues in terms of goals in the side and, you know, whether there's enough support there for Reece Thompson. Maybe we'll see a new role player come in. But I think having people like Bates and Oliver back, more creative players coming back to full fitness for these big games will give the team a good chance.
Pete, any thoughts?
No, that's wraps about it.
Yeah, well, touching on new players coming in, we've got the young lad from Barnsley, Templeton.
Yeah.
Just quickly touch on that, because he's just signed this week. He might be the support that Reece Thompson needs. But again, it will mean messing around with formation somewhat. We were talking about this before everybody else arrived, in terms of you're going 2 up front, or possibly 3 up front, if it's going to be a 2. This lad's probably more a winger than an actual out-and-out like centre-forward by the sound of it, despite giving him the squad number 9, which was a bit misleading. More a winger than a... So you're potentially looking at the 3 up front.
Did you see the goalkeeper, the reserve goalkeeper the other week at number 2?
Oh, no.
Honestly, I just wish goals going past him. it was number 2.
Let's get back to 1 to 11. That's what
we want.
1 to 11, that's what we want.
1 to 11.
Yeah, yeah. That whole separate argument of, oh, he's a number 10. What? You mean inside left? Yeah.
An inside.
Maybe
there's some title on this. Yeah. Kids, what is an inside left from Uncle Pete?
what we call it, a vlog.
A vlog.
The inside left.
There we go.
Got the name for it, yeah.
Formation. Yeah, so I think Helsham's got options, aren't they, in terms of what he does with the players he's got. The fan at the back kind of idea is wet, isn't it, for a large extent, and kind of bottled it up a bit, but I think for me, you need Brogan in that team to do that, because he's got the experience and the intelligence of players at wing back, and Toppers on the other side seems to get it as well. But Tyrone Henry did that, who's been probably one of the fans of the season, I think, at the club, really. When he's asked to do that role, you can tell he's an inexperienced player, can't you? You know, he's not playing to his strengths, and that makes it difficult.
I think Tyrone's a better. Well, he plays in the 3 at the back. He's no wing back, and it's an important role, isn't it? Obviously, yeah. I mean, building your team around your wing backs, there's got to be people who can do it. So you do need Brogan back. And I think, in fairness, I think it was a bit of a well, we've got loads of centre halves. A bit like when Steve Bruce started playing at City, a lot of it came around when we were strong centre half, and they built from the back. So I think it did well to steady the ship, but it doesn't help them.
It's got the other end.
Yeah, the other end, which hopefully this kid can do, because losing Wood and Sutton. losing them back to Scunthorpe, they're a big loss, aren't they? Because they're both starting to come good. Obviously, Sutton looked a really good player. It took a little while to get into it, but just typical with loan players.
Yeah,
this is why you can't stand them sometimes. Is you take all you spend all that time getting them up to your level, and then you lose them. So he's got some big shoes to fill, I think. But Barnsley fans rave about him, don't they? I think he was getting games there when Lee Johnson was the manager.
Yeah, spoke to the Liam, the editor of the West Ham Bogs, the Barnsley fanzine, and he, as you just said, the previous manager raved about him, gave him a start. I believe he scored on his debut, and after that, he didn't get much of a look in when the new manager arrived. Hence, he's come to us on loan. So there is scope there. I think he started his career at left back, apparently, and he's steadily pushed his way forward. So he seems confident enough about scoring goals.
He's still single on it, starting at left back.
Yeah. Quite possibly. Yeah. So, especially if you're left footed.
Yeah.
So,
well, a certain Welshman now in Madrid.
Well, very true. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I'm like you. I like the five at the back. I think we looked a lot more solid when we played five at the back, but it does limit your options in terms of width. So if this lad is a leftish winger, and you've got Emma, you've got Curtis Bates, and two or more of them will miss out if you're going in a three-man midfield. You do negate the width with five at the back. And as you say, you need Brogan pushing on and Topo pushing on that bit more to make it kind of work in an attacking.
I think more than anything, just Hamstrom just needs some options, doesn't he? Because at the moment, I mean, the bench on Saturday had three players who, with the greatest respect, will never get on the pitch with their team, either. You know, Fonzie Mbenze, Jordan Douglas, and Jordan Cook. They're not going to be in the team, are they? They're not kind of played at this level before. So it needs more bodies, doesn't it, to be able to sort of tinker with the formation and try and get it right.
Yeah, I think that's all it, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's options, isn't it? Some options.
And he's under the body on board, so. Right, so we'll move on from Ferriby, because our intention is to cover all the local football.